Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Nirav Shah, and I am the director of the State of Maine Center for Disease Control and Prevention. I'm here today with you to provide an update on the COVID-19 situation across the state. And today's update again begins on a somber note. The Maine CDC is reporting an additional individual with COVID-19 who passed away. This individual was a man in his 80s from Cumberland County. The sad passing of this individual marks the 36th death from COVID-19 across the state of Maine. And as always, all of us here at the state offer our condolences to the family of this individual during this time of grief. Overall, Maine CDC is now reporting a total of 888 cases of COVID-19 across the state. That's an increase of 13 cases since yesterday. Presently, there have been 139 individuals who have been hospitalized at some point during their COVID-19 illness. That's an increase of one since yesterday. Overall, right now in Maine, 40 individuals remain hospitalized, 16 in intensive care, and 24 in non-intensive care. And 8 individuals right now remain on ventilators. 443 have recovered since Maine CDC began its activation, which represents an increase of 30 recoveries since yesterday. And all told, there are 215 healthcare workers who have been affected by COVID-19, an increase of 3 since yesterday. Since beginning our work around COVID-19, Maine CDC epidemiologists have fielded now 5,162 requests for consultation from healthcare providers and medical personnel across the state. I'd like next to provide an update on the 5 outbreaks in long-term care and assisted living facilities that Maine CDC is currently tracking and providing technical assistance with. The first is an outbreak of COVID-19 at the Augusta Center for Health and Rehabilitation. At present, there are 47 residents, 26 staff who have been affected by COVID-19 for a total of 73. That remains unchanged since yesterday. At the Falmouth facility, there are 7 residents and 7 staff for a total of 14, also unchanged since yesterday. At the Maine Veterans Home in Scarborough, there have been 30 residents and 17 staff who have been diagnosed with COVID-19. There has sadly been an additional individual who passed away at that facility, bringing the total number of deaths associated with the Maine Veterans Home to 5, and the total number of individual diagnosed cases to 47, which is also unchanged since yesterday. At the Tall Pines facility in Waldo County, there have been 29 residents diagnosed with COVID-19. That's an increase of 1 case since yesterday. There have also been 10 staff who have been diagnosed, for a total now of 39 cases. Again, an increase of 1 since yesterday. And at the Cedars facility in Portland, 7 residents and 3 staff have been diagnosed, for a total of 10, which is the same as yesterday. Overall, there are 120 residents and 63 staff members affiliated or associated with long-term care facilities who have been affected by COVID-19 across the state. I'd like to turn next to just provide a quick update on our work around PPE as well as vital medical assets. We'll start with the vital assets first. In terms of the total number of intensive care units, there are 317 total ICU beds in Maine, 149 of which are available. There are also 336 traditional ventilators across the state, 281 of which are available. And there remain available a total of 369 alternative ventilators across the state. I'd like next to provide an update on our total inventories of personal protective equipment. At present, there are approximately 194,000 N95 masks in inventory, about 117,000 masks, about 1,500 face shields, just under 12,000 gloves, about 2,600 disposable protective suits, and about 5,700 surgical gowns. Yesterday, Maine CDC staff, working with our colleagues at the Department of Transportation, filled a total of 61 orders of PPE to healthcare providers across the state. Given the continued number of outbreaks that we've seen in long-term care facilities, the bulk of those deliveries went to such congregate care settings. Overall, just yesterday alone, Maine CDC staff, again working with our colleagues at the Department of Transportation, distributed 5,110 N95 masks, 9,440 surgical gowns, 7,400 gloves, 1,620 gowns, surgical gowns, 2,329 face shields, and 500 disposable protective suits, those so-called Tyvek suits, for a total number of pieces of PPE distributed yesterday of 26,339 to 61 facilities across the state. Again, that's 26,000 pieces of PPE delivered just yesterday alone. And I'd like to take a second to thank our colleagues at the Department of Transportation, as well as our colleagues at the National Guard, who for several weeks now have been serving as our logistics partners to make sure that these orders of PPE get immediately pulled, packed, and shipped out to facilities as we know they need them. Overall, since beginning our work distributing PPE, Maine CDC has now distributed PPE to over 1,070 facilities across the state. Again, some of those facilities have received multiple orders, but there have been 1,070 healthcare facilities across the state that have received PPE. And this ranges from regional hospitals to local fire, EMS, and rescue organizations to congregate care settings like the long-term care facilities where we know our parents, spouses, and siblings live. And again, I'd like to thank our colleagues at the Department of Transportation and the National Guard, as well as the Public Health Emergency Preparedness Team at the Maine CDC for making those deliveries happen. For the past several weeks, we've talked a lot about the work that frontline healthcare providers are doing to keep people in Maine safe. We've talked a lot about their quiet, powerful heroism, going to work every single day at a time when many of us are staying home, and how by doing so, by choosing to go to work, by choosing to take that risk and displaying that courage, they have helped to keep Maine people safe. Those individuals have taken care of people in Maine, and I'd like to spend a moment to talk about ways in which we are taking care of them. Displaying that courage, displaying that quiet, powerful heroism entails recognizing and getting up every morning knowing that your workplace is a place of risk. And doing that every day, we know, can take an emotional toll on individuals who are doing so. And that's why today, the Mills administration is announcing a frontline warm line. This frontline warm line is designed to help Maine's healthcare workers and first responders manage the potential emotional toll of COVID-19. This phone support service is staffed by volunteers And the frontline warm line, which officially launches today, will help Maine healthcare workers, first responders, and others who are contending with COVID-19 as they provide healthcare and other services. It will help those individuals manage the stress of serving on the front lines of the fight against the COVID-19 pandemic. This frontline warm line is intended to serve healthcare professionals, as well as emergency medical service personnel, law enforcement, and anyone else who is directly responding to the pandemic across the state. The line is being graciously staffed by volunteer professionals who have been activated through the Maine Response Network. The Maine Response Network is a network of volunteers, individuals, each and every one of you, who have decided to volunteer and enlist with Maine Response to offer their professional services. And that's who's staffing this warm line. It's your friends and neighbors across the state who have experience in mental health counseling, who have decided that they would like to assist those who are on the front lines. And those folks include licensed psychiatrists, psychologists, therapists, social workers, nurse practitioners, and other skilled professionals who can help frontline workers contend with the anxiety, stress, or grief that we know can come from dealing with COVID-19. This effort is a joint effort by and among the Maine Department of Health and Human Services, the Maine Department of Public Safety's Division of Emergency Medical Services, the Maine Association of Psychiatric Physicians, our colleagues at the Opportunity Alliance, the Maine Psychological Association, and Maine's chapter of the National Association of Social Workers. I'd like to take a moment to thank each and every one of those groups for coming together in this way to help stand up this frontline warm line. If you're watching this and you are one of those frontline workers who's grappling with stress, anxiety, or grief arising from the work that you are doing every day, please know that help is available. And please call the Frontline Warm Line. The numbers are 207-221-8196 or 866-367-4440. Those numbers again are 207-221-8196 or 866-367-4440. I'd like again to thank each and every one of those individuals on the front line right now. The heroism that you display in going to work every day and taking the care of Maine people who need that help is nothing short of astonishing. And we want to be able to support you physically, emotionally, and in every other way possible as you continue to do that work. If you are struggling right now, please know that help is available and please call the Frontline Warm Line. As that discussion suggests and shows, it's hard being a medical provider these days. But it's also hard being a patient these days. Everyone watching right now is maybe concerned about seeking care because you've got concern for both yourself as well as potentially concern for your provider around COVID-19. You may not wish to be exposed to COVID-19 by virtue of going to the doctor's office or going to the hospital. And you may also be concerned about exposing your healthcare provider to the same thing. As we've talked about for so many weeks now, so much has changed in connection with COVID-19. And the way you receive care has changed as well. The way you receive medical care right now may be different. But working with your provider to stay well and manage any chronic medical conditions you may have has doubtless become more challenging But we cannot put that type of medical care completely on hold, even as we grapple with COVID-19. What we don't want to do is create a silent sub-epidemic of people who need care but dare not come in. And we've heard anecdotally across the state, across the country, that folks are afraid to come in and see their doctor, and that folks are afraid to call 911, and folks are afraid to go to the ER, even if they might be acutely ill. People with diabetes, folks who have high blood pressure, and those who might need regular lab tests to adjust their levels of blood thinners. Each and every one of you still needs to receive that usual medical care. And again, we've been hearing from folks that people across the state and across the country are fearful to seek care for non-COVID issues. But what I'd like to share with everyone today is the importance of continuing to seek that care and doing so in partnership with your doctor. The relationship that you have with your medical provider, whoever that may be, is really, truly a partnership. And as a patient, that partnership that you have with your medical provider is more important than ever right now. For any good partnership to work, there has to be good communication. And so what I'm asking everyone to do today is that if you've been hesitant to call your medical provider because of concerns you might have of COVID-19, don't be hesitant. Please call them. We don't often like to talk about what ails us, but this is a situation where we must not let our concerns about COVID-19 become the reason we don't talk about what's ailing us, or be the reason we don't take time to take care of our own health. Now, we know that there are challenges right now in routine medical visits, but given those challenges, communicating with your healthcare provider takes on an even greater importance today than it did just a few months ago. The healthcare system, much like most every other system right now, has changed the way that it works in order to minimize the risk of COVID-19. And the healthcare system across Maine is still continuing to provide care for everyone with a chronic medical condition, but just in different ways. But those different ways can change how each of you might interact with your medical provider or with the healthcare system. But recognizing those changes, I have a few concrete pieces of advice. The first is please do not be afraid to call 911. If you have signs or symptoms of an acute medical emergency, whether that's a heart attack or a stroke or an injury you may have suffered, please do not hesitate or delay in calling 911. The emergency medical system across Maine is staffed with first-rate professionals who are trained in and aware of how to manage any potential risk of COVID-19. They've got PPE, they've got the training, and they are standing by to take care of you if you have an acute medical emergency. So please do not be afraid to call 911. Another piece of advice is for any parents out there. You know that well child visits are critical for your child's health. COVID-19 is not an occasion to put those visits on hold. Pediatricians across the state of Maine are standing by to continue well child visits for your children. Please do not put those on hold for any of your children, notwithstanding COVID-19. Third, if you have a chronic health condition, like diabetes, that requires regular check-ins with your physician, those check-ins are just as important as they were before COVID-19. But they might happen in a different way. But even though they may happen in a different way, they are just as important, and I ask you not to put those on hold right now. Healthcare practices and medical providers across Maine are still able to provide healthcare. But again, it may be in a different way. Some may be offering consultations by telephone. Others may be doing so by telemedicine. Those are new. Those are different. Even though they've been around, they've taken on more importance. Medicine is constantly evolving. And trust me when I tell you that those types of visits can take some getting used to. But frankly, so much of the way that we are living now takes a lot of getting used to. From doing cocktail parties via Zoom to now perhaps seeing your doctor on FaceTime. Those visits are just as important right now as they were before. Even though we're in this era where physical distancing is critical, even though we know it's one of the best ways to prevent the spread of the virus, keeping those social connections, as we've talked about, is important. Keeping those medical connections is just as important. And so your medical providers across the state are waiting to hear from you. So with that, I'd like to take a couple of questions from our colleagues in the media. And today's first question starts with Steve Missler from Maine Public. Go ahead, Steve.
Thanks, Dr. Shah. I appreciate it. Two quick questions, I think. One, I'm curious about your take on a study out of Cleveland, which showed that the Abbott test, this rapid test that I think Maine is hoping will be part of its testing strategy going forward, had something like a 15% rate of false negatives. I'm curious if you've seen that or heard of that research and how that might affect Maine's testing strategy. And then the second question I have is about this new CMS requirement that nursing homes report cases to them, how that might affect how Maine CDC goes about reporting outbreaks at long-term care facilities and nursing homes.
Great. Thanks for those two questions, Steve. Steve's first question is about the about concerns that have been raised about the Abbott ID Now rapid test. Steve, as Steve notes, we received 15 of those tests and 5 test cartridges from the federal government. And Steve, we are aware of not just those results, but results that have been circulated by other groups. Some groups across the country, in fact, groups across the world, have run these so-called validation or accuracy studies, comparing every new diagnostic test against the gold standard. And it is the case that the accuracy of this new Abbott test does vary greatly. Some have put the accuracy in the bound that you mentioned. Some have put it a bit higher. But in any event, and in all events, those questions have raised concerns. Just to be clear about what the early data show, the early data suggests concerns around the sensitivity as opposed to the specificity. What that means is that a positive result is something that we can have faith in. A positive result on the Abbott machine suggests that the person does in fact have COVID. But a negative result is a bit more in question. Recognizing that those early data, which I've been aware of for a couple of weeks coming out of different research laboratories, in light of those data, Steve, here's what we've done. We have asked every single recipient of one of the Abbott machines in the state of Maine to send us a large batch of their negative results. Again, the positive results are ones we have faith in, but the negative results may have a bit of a question mark. So we have asked recipients of each and every one of the Abbott machines to send us a high number, a batch of their negative results, so that we can test them against the gold standard at our laboratory to try to get a better scientific handle on what's going on. The other advice that we have given to all the recipients of the machines thus far is as follows. If you have a patient who you strongly believe has COVID-19, perhaps they are the spouse of a confirmed case, and you test them on the Abbott ID Now platform, and they come back negative, you should still treat them as if they were COVID-19 positive until you hear back from our laboratory. So those are the two steps that we've taken in recognition, not just of the latest results that you note, Steve, but results that we've been aware of that even haven't been published yet, going back a couple of weeks now. Those results raised flags for us, and those are the remediative steps that we put into place to make sure we were aware of those. Your second question is about new rules from CMS. We're aware of those rules. We don't think that they will significantly alter the public health side of things. Certainly, they may alter some of the reporting that nursing facilities may have to do up to CMS, but we're in touch with nursing facilities and they report cases to us via the laboratories. So it won't probably change the day-to-day rhythm of the public health epidemiological investigation. But again, certainly we are aware of that CMS change. So thanks for that question, Steve. Next up is Emily Tadlock at WABI.
Thanks so much, Dr. Shah. My question today is, there's been one confirmed case of coronavirus at Hope House Homeless Shelter in Bangor. What is being done to protect the transient population when there are varied housing situations across the state, and how are they being tested and treated?
Great. So Emily's question is about cases of COVID-19 amongst people who are experiencing homelessness and what our approach is there. So Emily, a few observations. The first is congregate settings such as shelters where people experiencing homelessness reside are of top concern for us. Several weeks ago, at these meetings, we talked about an uptick in cases at the Oxford Street shelter in Portland. We were aware of the possibility, though, that there could be other cases elsewhere in the state, and we've now seen one case in Bangor. Our approach to congregate settings is a fewfold. The first is, as we do with long-term care facilities, we want to make sure that the folks who are working in those facilities have a sufficient amount of personal protective equipment. The second thing that we're working on is, again, recognizing the close settings that those folks live in, there's a high degree of probability of transmission. So for that reason, we are actually rapidly deploying one of the Abbott tests that Steve Missler and I were just talking about to a federally qualified health center in Bangor so that they can conduct rapid tests on any individual, but certainly those individuals from the congregate care setting who might be experiencing symptoms. And then the third is, what do we do if or when we find those individuals? And the answer there is that it's multifold. If a person is positive, there are plans in place to ensure that they have a safe place in which they can be isolated. And if someone is negative, as we talked about with Steve, we take a closer look at their clinical symptoms, given that they're in a congregate setting and given some concerns that have been raised internationally about the Abbott test. Our epidemiologists and our medical advisors provide case-by-case advice on whether a particular individual who tests negative should be treated as if they might have the disease anyways for public health isolation concerns. So it's obviously a very challenging situation, as are any congregate care settings. And that's why we've kind of been planning around these settings, whether they be long-term care facilities or shelters for folks experiencing homelessness. Right now, where we are with respect to these shelters is that we're not building the boat and trying to sail it at the same time. We knew early on that these situations would arise. And so we're following the plans that we have in place pursuant to the discussions that we've had with city officials about how these situations would go. I'd like to turn next to Amy Brown over at WERU. Go ahead, Amy.
Thank you, Dr. Shah. As I'm sure you're aware, Senator Angus King has signed on to a letter along with several other senators expressing concerns to the Trump administration about the safety of the U.S. food supply and concerns about workers not receiving adequate PPE and testing at places like processing facilities and grocery stores. Is the state doing anything to provide PPE for frontline grocery store employees or making them higher priority for testing? And then also, could you give us an update on the rest of the shelters and the Department of Corrections testing situation, please?
Sure. I'll start with your latter question first, Amy. With respect to the Department of Corrections, as of this morning, there are no positive cases at any of the state correctional facilities. With respect to the other homeless shelters or shelters for people experiencing homelessness across the state, we'll get you the latest updated numbers. There have not been any new cases in a few days now, but I believe we're at six, but I will make sure I get you the most updated numbers there. Now, with respect to the food supply system overall, both on the processing side as well as on the retail side, certainly the implications of having gaps in our ability to have food are staggering. As you may have seen, Amy, a recent in South Dakota, a meat processing facility recently had to come offline because of concerns around a number of individual employees for COVID. We have kept tabs on those situations. Generally speaking, facilities of that nature are managed and investigated by the U.S. Department of Agriculture as opposed to any state entity. But we've been in contact to make sure that any of those facilities that could affect Maine, we've got eyes on them so we can keep tabs on what's going on. Now, with respect to grocery stores, that too has been an item of discussion. There hasn't been any final decision that's been made, but I do want to note that many grocery stores in Maine now are taking even more steps to keep customers as well as employees safe. Many of them, I haven't visited a grocery store but in quite some time, but by report from others, the plexiglass shields are up. Many of the grocery stores have now instituted what amounts to one-way aisles to reduce the amount of interaction and reduce the spread. So those are the types of measures that we know can continue to keep folks safe, even as they do have to do what they need to do, which is to minimize or to obtain food. I'd like to turn next to Kevin Miller at the Press Herald.
Yeah, hi, Dr. Shah. Thanks again. So two questions for you. Today, I think a lot of us, we keep track of the active, what we call the active cases, which is, you know, the number of total cases, you know, taking out the folks who've recovered or passed away. Active cases actually, number of people who've recovered has actually gone above the number of active cases we have today. Just want to get your thoughts on that and what that means for the trends. And then a secondary question about long-term care facilities. Looking at the Waldo County numbers, I was struck by, it looks like the residents there who passed away actually stayed at that facility as opposed to going to a hospital. I know you probably can't talk about individual facilities, but can you talk a little bit about whose decision that is, about whether a seriously ill patient at a congregate care facility goes to a hospital or whether they stay in place?
Sure.
Robert and I had a little bit of exchange on that, but I wonder if you could elaborate on it.
Yeah, absolutely, Kevin. I'll take those in reverse order. Kevin's first question is about long-term care facilities and specifically the conditions under which an individual at a long-term care facility who's ill with COVID-19 or perhaps any other disease, under what conditions and under whose decision is it for them to go to a hospital? And Kevin, the answer there, the bottom line answer, is that that decision is fundamentally made by the resident, the family members, and their healthcare providers. Maine CDC, the state overall, does not intercede in that decision making. We don't get involved in terms of when folks should go and under what conditions they ought to. What I can also indicate, Kevin, is that in many situations, advanced care planning is a topic of discussion at long-term care facilities. As you noted, I can't go into any of the specifics of any particular patient, but we are aware, and my experience has been, that at long-term care facilities, advanced care planning is a discussion that is often had, and those discussions can govern when, if someone does get critically ill, whether their wish is to go to the hospital or to remain at their home, which is the long-term care facility. So, that's kind of the bottom line there. But the answer really is that is a shared decision made by the resident, their family, and their healthcare provider. Your first question is about active cases or cases that are not accounted for by individuals who have passed or those who have recovered. And you're correct on the recovered point. And You know, Kevin, I think I have to go back to what I said yesterday, which is we're still in the middle of this. Even though the number of recovered individuals is rising, it's up 30 today compared to yesterday, we're still very much in the thick of things. We're seeing additional cases, and given the low numbers that we have in Maine, any one day's change is difficult to interpret. When you've got tens of thousands of cases per day or thousands per day, as some cities and states do, the small changes don't impact as much. But here in Maine, with a smaller number of overall cases, our trends are exquisitely sensitive to day-to-day variations. And so, unfortunately, Kevin, I can't really speculate on what any one of these things means, other than to say, again, we're still in the middle of things. I'd like to turn next to Megan over at WMTW.
I have a question about kind of how you figure into the recovered cases. If someone is discharged from the hospital and considered, I guess, recovered, but can still test positive for COVID-19, are they considered recovered, or are they still grouped in with positive cases? And are they still contagious?
Okay. So Megan's questions are about what do we mean by recovery? And what is it, and is someone who has recovered potentially still contagious? And Megan, in this regard, for recovered, we follow the U.S. CDC's medical and scientific guidelines to a T. And the U.S. CDC offers two pathways through which someone could be deemed to be recovered. One pathway is through continued testing. And if a doctor chooses to, they could continue to test a patient. And when they've tested negative twice over a certain number of days, they could be deemed to be recovered. That was the main way people were recovered very early on in the epidemic. The bulk of folks now become recovered through the other pathway, which is through resolution of their symptoms. And it requires a couple of things to happen, but in short, your symptoms have to have recovered for a period of days when you're not taking any kind of medication, and a certain number of days have had to elapse since you first had your first symptom. And once all of those criteria have been met, you're deemed to be recovered. Right now, there's no evidence to suggest that someone who matches that criteria can spread the disease to anybody else. There have been a couple of scientific reports of folks who still have some microscopic number of viral particles detected in their blood, but it's not known whether that small number of viral particles means that they could spread the disease to others. And in fact, in a number of other types of viral infections, you can test people for days, weeks after they've recovered and still find a little bit of DNA in their body. But that doesn't mean they're contagious. And based on what the US CDC's research has showed, that holds true for coronavirus, for COVID-19. So that's the approach that we take. Thanks for that question, Megan. We'll turn next to Brad Rogers over at WGME.
Thanks, Dr. Shah. Just a couple of quick questions here. Vice President Pence, he said for a few days now that states have enough COVID-19 tests to start to reopen. I think you disagree with that, correct?
What I would say is that we are still in a situation where additional testing capacity would be needed. And we are planning and working to build out additional testing capacity.
Okay.
And Brad, you said you had a couple of questions. I want to make sure.
Yep. Up any time. All right. Sorry about that. Have your disease detectives found any evidence of people getting COVID-19? Now, I'm not talking about people in a nursing home or healthcare workers, but other folks getting COVID-19 from ignoring physical distancing and other recommendations.
So Brad's second question is about whether we've traced any type of cases of COVID-19 to folks who might have not been abiding physical distancing requirements. And Brad, as of right now, we're not aware of any such cases. But given that the most number of people in Maine live in counties where community transmission is known to occur. It's an open question about whether that has happened, and our disease detectives would just not know because it's community transmission, and you may never know exactly where someone got infected. So the answer, Brad, is that we haven't detected it, but for many people in Maine, given the most populous counties, it is an unanswerable question.
Okay, thanks.
You bet. Okay. And we will turn next to Caitlin Andrews at the BDN.
Thank you, Dr. Shah. I have two things I wanted to ask about. One is that it seems like hospitalizations are slowing in the state, and I want to know if the CDC is reading anything into that trend and if you are factoring that into your planning going forward. And then I wanted to ask about the FDA approved the first in-home test for COVID-19, and the company selling a test says that it will be available first to healthcare workers and later to consumers. Is this a resource that Maine is planning to rely on in order to ease the testing backlog?
Great. So Caitlin's first question is about the plateauing of hospitalizations and what we could say about that. And Caitlin, you know, the number of hospitalizations has come down a bit, but it is at something of a plateau. And a plateau does not mean things are getting better. It just means that they're not getting worse at an increasing rate. So still 40 individuals across the state remain hospitalized. 8 of them remain ventilated. Similar to Kevin's question, because of those small numbers, now each of those numbers is of course significant to the family members, but as a modeling exercise, because the numbers are small, they are sensitive to day-to-day changes. And it does make reading into those day-to-day changes a bit of a challenge. What I can tell you, Caitlin, is two things. The first is given the number of outbreaks that we are working with long-term care facilities on, and again, also somewhat similar to Kevin's question, one of the things that we're working on is preparing hospitals for the possibility that numbers of patients from long-term care facilities may need to be transferred to hospitals from long-term care facilities if they so choose and if their condition worsens. That would increase the number of hospitalizations. The other thing that we are working on in concert with that is making sure that we don't take our foot off the gas. Even though the hospitalizations have plateaued, we're still ramping up, for example, the number of contact tracers that we have, the number of disease detectives that we have. We know that if we take our foot off the gas too soon, the possibility of a secondary spike in cases is high. It's pronounced. It's happened in other countries. And that secondary spike could hit long-term care facilities as hard, if not harder, than the first one. And then, Caitlin, your second question is around the FDA's new test. We're reviewing that test. The EUA just came out about 4 hours ago, and so we're taking a look at it. One of the things that our antenna are up for are around the technical specifications of the test. Because of the way the FDA and the speed at which they are moving right now, things are getting approved without necessarily having the full battery of tests, which means that our laboratory staff, our statisticians, have to be extra careful to review those data right now to make sure we know what we're actually acquiring. There have been a number of stories in the media in recent days, the national media in recent days, of health departments across the country that have made quick investments in new tests only to find that those data around the tests were not what they thought it was going to be. I don't want to make that mistake here in Maine, so we're taking a look at all the data here.
You mentioned that you may be looking at other ways to expand your testing capacity. Can you talk about that a little bit more?
Sure. So Caitlin asks about other ways we want to expand our testing capacity. And really here, Caitlin, this goes back to diversifying the portfolio of testing equipment that we have available at our laboratory. To go back to my tortured metaphor around baking, we're trying to get not just more ingredients, reagents, but also additional pieces of equipment that will help us expand the number of tests that we can do. So those plans have been in place going back About a month ago, we talked about one piece that we purchased. It is supposed to be delivered very soon, but we're also working with different laboratory testing companies to try to see if we should adopt their platforms, knowing that those companies might have a deeper supply chain of the reagents, the chemicals that we need. We've been in really active discussions with a couple of different companies. One in particular looks very productive, but we're still going through the diligence. If that were to come through, what that would mean is a much more robust supply chain for the chemicals, the reagents that do the testing. That will allow us to expand our capacity even more.
What piece are you referring to that was mentioned a month ago, just so I can be clear on
that?
Yeah,
this is it's called an extractor platform that we acquired from a company, as you may recall, I declined at the time to name the company to Steve Missler because of concerns about the demand for those. I don't mind sharing now that this is a platform that we purchased from a company called Thermo Fisher. We are in communication with the company. We were hoping to have received it a few weeks ago. We understand that the company is trying to get us a device as quickly as possible.
Thank you.
You bet. Next question goes to Don Kerrigan at News Center. Don? We're going to come back to Don. Oh, go ahead, Don. Yep, yes. I can hear you.
Okay, thank you. That mute-unmute thing caught me again. The follow-up on the testing, and you've answered part of this, but I wanted to ask it anyway. Since the governor has talked about, at the national level, talking about more robust testing being key to being able to open the economy, how do you have any idea how long it would take you to be able to ramp up the amount of supplies, the amount of actual test kits, if that's an appropriate term, as well as this additional equipment, to be able to test significantly more people? And what do you envision, as you think about this, would be a significant increase in testing enough to help make some of these larger decisions?
Great questions, Don. The first question is around the timeline that we might anticipate to be able to expand testing. And Don, I want to start my answer in two ways. The first is to note that the testing capacity overall in the state has greatly expanded since we began this work many, many weeks ago. Initially, it was just Maine CDC's lab, then the Nordex lab affiliated with Maine Health. Now, a number of other hospital laboratories are able to provide testing for COVID-19, including the laboratory at Northern Light Healthcare. So that has also been increasing. The other piece that's expanded is the number of commercial laboratories in Maine that also offer testing: LabCorp, Quest, et cetera. So we shouldn't forget about those. Even though I tend to speak about what's going on at the Maine CDC lab, there is a bit more to the testing landscape than Maine CDC. So Don, as to the timeline, as I just noted with Caitlin, this is something that we've been working on now for over a month to try to expand the supplies and the hardware that we have to undertake the testing. Right now, the main decision on the table is whether what we understand to be the supply of chemicals that is being that's out there from some of the machines that we use, whether that supply is robust enough, or whether it's time that we switch to a different platform that we know will have a deeper bench. That's a discussion that's actually been occurring pretty robustly for a few weeks, and even more intensely just in the past 48 hours or so, as we've been evaluating different ideas and different proposals. In terms of a timeline, Don, I don't have a hard and fast one, other than to say soon. And once we've got a decision on what our expansion strategy will be, we'll certainly be willing to discuss it. The other piece that you raised, Don, is about, well, the other piece that I just want to note is we've been talking thus far today about what is so-called PCR testing. And it's also important to note that there's a different type of testing out there, antibody testing, that we're simultaneously evaluating to see how that fits in with any part of a broader strategy. Both are necessary. Both are required. But the precise numbers of both that we would need to have that are offered at the same time, that's a little bit, that changes because it's a sliding scale. And so we don't exactly have numbers that we say we need to be producing or we need to be conducting. But suffice it to say, Don, we're looking at, I concur with Dr. Anthony Fauci. Of course I concur with Dr. Fauci. Who wouldn't? But I concur with Dr. Fauci insofar as that we need to be looking at numbers that would imply at least a doubling or a tripling of our total capacity for testing in the state. Not just at Maine CDC, but all of the testing that's offered statewide. I'd like to turn next to Michael Fern from the Maine Edge.
Thank you, Dr. Shah. Just a quick follow-up to Don's question. Yesterday at the White House briefing, the Dr. Birx, I believe, put up a map of the whole U.S. with all of the testing centers. Were there any identified new to you in Maine, or are some federal facilities now available?
Michael's question is about a map that the White House has circulated and has used in some of their briefings. We've taken a look at the map as well as a spreadsheet that's also been circulated. And to be candid, it didn't exactly align with what our understanding is. There are no federal testing sites in Maine that I am aware of, unlike in other states, for example, in Maryland. And some of the, much of the data that was on that map, Michael, was data that was provided to the White House by manufacturers. It's not necessarily data that Maine CDC would have. So if testing company X sells a testing machine to a clinic in Waterville, Maine CDC doesn't necessarily get notified of that. And so much of what was on that map was data that was culled from the manufacturers themselves. Some of the data that was on there, we didn't think was quite right. For example, the accounting of what Maine CDC's own laboratory has just down the street in Augusta wasn't quite accurate. We also noted some omissions of other laboratories in Maine that we know to operate that weren't included on that list. So I'm not sure what to make of it. We're trying to get a better handle on what that diagram means and how it might impact our strategy right now. I'd like to turn next to Patrick Whittle at the Associated Press.
Thank you, Dr. Shah. I appreciate it. We were talking yesterday a bit about contact tracing. I just wanted to follow up on that a little bit. Since the state is continuing to do this, I would like to get some kind of idea of how many people the state is utilizing to do contact tracing. And also, if you could sort of explain the methodology behind the number of people who are being used to do this, and also talk a little bit about what that means for staffing levels for the state's public health system as a whole, because I know staffing is finite and this is a pretty huge endeavor.
Yep. Great. Thanks for those questions, Patrick. So Patrick's questions are around the staffing component that goes into the contact tracing piece. We've talked a lot about contact tracing. This is where disease detectives call up individuals who are confirmed and ask them everywhere they've been in the past 16 days, everyone they've closely interacted with, and then we call all those people and do the same thing. And the goal of contact tracing is that it's part of a fundamental strategy, kind of a triangle, to box in the coronavirus. And contact tracing is one part of that triangle. The other pieces being rapid identification through testing, and then the other leg of the triangle being isolation of people with whom we've been in contact with. So all three pieces of the triangle, all three sides are essential to box in coronavirus. Now, Patrick, you ask about the staffing pieces particularly. Our goal for this phase of the coronavirus activation is to have approximately 30 individuals conducting contact tracing. That's just for this phase. So I want to emphasize that number may change. If the number of cases goes up, then we will need to commensurately hire additional individuals. There are different metrics out there around how to think about the approximate number of contact tracers, but generally speaking, we're taking an approach that one individual contact tracer can monitor about 30 to 40 people. Now, obviously, the first phone call takes a long time, but after that, it consists of checking in with folks to see if they have any new symptoms, to see if they've gotten sicker, or to see if they've met the criteria to be recovered. And so that's sort of the model we're looking at right now. But if the complexity of cases increases, or if we get more and more cases in congregate care settings, where the nature of the investigation is very technical, we may have to change that staffing model. So Patrick, that's how we're thinking about it right now. And much as we've talked about in these meetings with most of our work, it's stepwise. I go back to that analogy of climbing the stairs. With respect to contact tracing, we're continuing to climb the stairs one step more at a time. Our goal for this phase is to be at approximately 30. And if the outbreak gets considerably worse or the complexion becomes more complex, then we'll hire even more. And that will determine sort of the skill level. So does that answer your question, Patrick?
Yes, for the most part it does. It's also reasonable to assume that with fewer cases, it would also go down, right? And also, these are all state employees, or are any of them at the county or municipal level?
As to your former question, Patrick, about what might happen if the cases go down, yes. In the event that we started seeing a decline in cases over a sustained period of time, then commensurate to that, there would be a decrease in the number of contact tracers that would be needed. And right now, given the structure of the public health system in Maine, we're looking at these being state-level employees as opposed to county or municipal level. But overall, Patrick, I think the bigger point, and this has been documented in reports that have come out over the past couple of weeks, there is a nationwide shortage of public health staff. And health departments across the country for years have been chronically understaffed, not just in Maine, but across virtually every jurisdiction in the country. And as we've talked about at these meetings, what epidemics do is not so much create cracks in the system, but really reveal the cracks in the system. And what we're seeing now is the chronic understaffing of public health departments. And now, and in a time of stress, the need to staff up really quickly. That's what we're doing. It's the plan that we've been working on for some time. And as the outbreak changes, our plans will continue to evolve. Before we wrap up today, everyone, again, I'd really just like to take a moment to remind everybody, whether you have a chronic medical condition, whether you have a young child that needs a well child checkup, or you're acutely ill and need to call 911, please reach out to your medical providers. They have adapted the way that they provide healthcare in order to keep you as safe as possible. They are standing by and have been continuing to keep Maine people safe and healthy. Please don't delay in reaching out to them. Now is still a good time to get healthcare. All right, thank you very much, everyone, and we'll talk tomorrow.
Thanks, Josh.